words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts to be acceptable to your Son, O Lord, our God and our Lord.
Amen.
Mom, our teacher told us that the world took millions of years to become like it is. How come the Bible says it took only 6 days? As a parent, you haven't been looking for that, have you? It came after I was left feeding. So you stole it. Cindy, don't ask me to respond to the question. Feeding, we assume, needs our protection. Its enemy, curiosity. But the one who fashions the universe, fashioned our brains, the more that you and I question and discover the world around us, the closer we approach the divine creator. In time, young Cindy will come to fathom the meaning of metaphor. She'll understand scripture as sometimes surpassing the will. So, if faith has an enemy, it's not working in an inquisitive fifth grade. Something else erodes our faith. It's called negativity. The resistance we often put up against good news. It wasn't curiosity that stifled Thomas's faith, that plugged his ears to the joyful cry, "He has risen." From the writer John, we get a preview of Thomas's somewhat doleful mindset. Before they come into Jerusalem, they had learned of the death of Lazarus. And as Jesus set out to visit the bereaved sisters, Mary and Martha, Thomas said, "Well, let us go too, that we might die along with him." Now, he may have meant die along with Lazarus from whatever disease had taken him, or more likely, die along with Jesus, whom the opponents already were stalking. At any rate, he voiced certainty that bad things would come from the distance. Later on, the same negative posture would make Thomas reject the good news. "Sure, he's risen, and my name's Augustus Caesar." The same kind of mindset can block you and me as we process information. Some years ago, while living in Baltimore, I was walking back to our home. We lived in a row house in a diverse neighborhood. Race relations had become even more extreme in those months after Dr. King's slaying. On front steps, shortly ahead of me, sat some young men, African American, and every few seconds they were emitting shouts which sounded to me a bit ominous. Now, were I across the street to avoid them, that might be noticed all anew. So I swallowed hard and passed right in front of them. As it turned out, they were gathered around a radio tuned into a pennant player. And their shouts were coming whenever the Orioles made some inroad in the game. Having braced for the hostile, I was overwhelmed by the wholesome. And as we heard in this morning's gospel, the doubting disciple turned the corner. "Come on, Thomas," spoke the risen one. "Look for yourself at the nail marks. healed the wound in my side from the spear, and Thomas, for once in your life, be positive. And it worked. My Lord and my God, he cried. He did shoo after him. Tradition tells us that of all the apostles, Thomas would travel the farthest. So full of the good news he'd become that he'd bear it to the Indian. Bar Tona, oldest branch of the church east of Ethiopia, still carries the name of its founding missionary. As people of God, you and I do not gloss over life's downturns, ill fortune, and evil we face for what it is. A neighbor with prostate cancer, you don't tell glibly, it's nothing serious. And when children lose lives in mass shootings, we weep with the family. And yes, some people, some young people on front steps in cities do harass strangers passing by. But as we face fearful moments and even death, we know they'll finish the story. We know that the Nazarene's triumph embraces us. Maybe the world took skillions of years to come into being, or maybe a big bang caused it to happen in minutes. Someday we may be privy to know for certain. In the meantime, should I hear a ruckus from young people on the doorstep, I'll assume that their favorite team